Good morning, everybody. I'll be talking about the basics in biometry for the cataract surgeries. So what are the pearls? As you all know, what is biometry? Basically, we're measuring the various physical parameters and using this data to calculate the ideal intraocular lens power for that particular patient. And the first thing which we have to do is gather a good data. So that's the most important thing. And what are the essential data which has to be gathered is the keratometry and your exit length. And additional, which are required for certain newer formulas, is AC depth, white to white, and the lens thickness. Who should be performing it? That's again very important. It is a matter of great responsibility. So please, either the surgeon himself or a very well-trained assistant should be performing it. When it should be done? It should be done quite early before the surgery so that you get time to calculate the power, time to counsel the patient what type of lens you are putting, implanting in his eye. And especially if there are odd powers, like very low powers or very high powers, you get time to arrange a specific IOL. The keratometry is basically, as we all know, a situation of the corneal power, which is directly used in three ways in your IOL power calculations: directly as a part of the formula, indirectly for the estimation of effective lens position, and also for your astigmatic correction. Okay, so you should know the keratometry. Remember, obviously, this is based upon using the refractive index of cornea, 1.3375, and use this formula. The actual diopteric power is calculated based on that. There are various modalities by which we can measure this. But what is important, I'm just talking about the basics which you should take care when you're doing a keratometry. Always remember to calibrate your instrument regularly. Always have a good tear film and untouched cornea. You should not have done any apponation, any gonioscopy, any contact ultrasonic measurements. Any contact procedure should not have been done on the cornea before you take your keratometry measurements, okay? Accurate centration is very important. Always occlude the other eye so that you get a centered central 3 mm of the keratometric readings, and take average of multiple readings. It should be done in a dark room. If there is evident scarring, if there is a corneal scar, in those cases you can use the keratometry of the other eye. And always remember to recheck if you are getting extreme values, less than 40 diopters or more than 48 diopters, and if there is an asymmetry of greater than 1.5 diopters between the two eyes. Exit length, again, we can either use ultrasonic measurements or an optical mode. Ultrasonic waves, obviously, as echoes are reflected as echoes from the various structures, and we are measuring the distances which are traversed. Again, while using the contact ultrasound, obviously, which is not a preferred modality nowadays, you should always calibrate your machine. Correct velocity settings should be there. A gentle touch. Don't press or don't indent. Look for good spikes. All the spikes should at least have 90% reflectivity. Okay. Appropriate gain settings depending on the density of the cataract. And again, axial alignment using a fixation light source. Again, take average of multiple readings, and the standard deviation of each reading should be less than 0.6 mm, 0.06 mm. Repeat if the difference between the two eyes is more than 0.3 mm. Record again before dilating the pupil. That's very important because most of the people have the tendency after dilatation, they have seen, assess the patient on the slit lamp, and then they are doing their biometry. Yeah. Again, this can give to fallacious fixation actually. So issues come with fixation there. Avoid using any ointments before the measurements. This is just a graph. So although it's easy to perform contact methods, it works for the density of the cataracts, cost effective, but there is a corneal compression, so you can have fallacies or as a result of false measurements. Risk of abrasion infection is always there, and misalignment issues can always occur. The improvement on this is by the immersion ultrasound, where we're using a specialized shell known as a Prager's shell. A water bath is basically created within the shell, and in which the tip of the probe is immersed. This is the actual instrument, how the Prager's shell looks like. Make sure that the patient is comfortable. Align the mark on the shell properly with your probe so that you're again taking axial measurements. Fill the chamber adequately. Don't overfill it. There should not be air bubbles when you're filling it. That's very important. Again, because that will lead to fallacious readings. Ask the patient, even when you're using a Prager's shell, to look into the fixation light of the probe. That's again important. The patient cannot be looking here and there, okay? And make sure, this is a very common mistake which people make, please change the mode on your ultrasonic machine. Sometimes people are measured in the contact mode, next person comes and does it in the immersion mode, and you have not changed the mode. You will get haywire readings, okay? So remember that. So obviously it is more accurate. There is no risk of corneal compression in this case. Works for the density of cataracts. Relatively cost effective. Just need to add a Prager shell to your ultrasonic basic ultrasonic machine. There's a slight learning curve, okay? And a special shell is needed as the patient can get wet. But that's all not very disadvantages as compared to the advantages which you can get using an immersion ultrasound. The optical is obviously a better instrument, I would say, but it does not work in all cases. It is based on the principle of partial coherence interferometry. And the resolution is therefore better because it is wavelength of this the infrared rays is much smaller than that of the ultrasonic waves. Ensure, again, while doing this optical measurements, please remember, obviously it's a non-contact technique, ensure that there's a moist ocular surface to get accurate reading, ensure again there is an axial alignment. Slight midrises in these cases, especially if there is a slight, not a dense PSC, in dense PSC may not take up the readings, but if there is a slight PSC, please, a slight midrises may be helpful in those cases. Choose the correct mode. As obviously it is fast, precise, and SNAI machine can be used for different measurements at the same time. No physical contact, no anesthesia, no corneal compression, and visual axis measurement is there. However, it is expensive and does not work if there is significant posterior subcapsular cataract. Once the data has been gathered, the surgeon must use one of the more IL-powered calculation formulas. There are multiple of formulas. SRKT or FSA is obsolete. Please don't use this formula. There's one example I have given here. If axial length of 22, it will give a correction of 22.95 with 21.99. So with only a difference of 0.01, it makes a difference of almost 1.03 in your calculations. So please don't use this. And this happens in several steps. Which formulas to use for short eyes, Hoffer Q, Hagee's, Holiday 2 can all be used. For average eyes, you can use Hill RBF and Barrett are the latest formulas which have been used. For long eyes, Barrett, Olsen, and Hagee's all work. But still, you may land up in a scenario where you have done an excellent surgery, you have a clear cornea, you have a quiet eye, but the patient is very, very unhappy. So the best solution to this would be...
Can you please sum up?
Yeah. The best solution to this would be, so basically do an optimization of your results, of your own results. For this, you just need all these parameters, all these data of your own, okay? Calculate a constant for a case of series and average these values, 25 or more of your cases would suffice. And you can do these calculations using manual calculations, your biometry machine, or you have software. This is one of the software which is available online and freely available. So in the end, I'll just summarize that biometry, both eyes should be measured. Always use a correct mode. Most individuals have a similar axial length, so remember that. Most corneas are regularly curved, again similar between the two individuals. Look for any asymmetry. If there's asymmetry, please repeat your measurements on different machines by different persons and different times. Then repeat on different days. Use multiple formulas. Always correct for the position of the back. If you're not able to place the aisle in the back, please, you're placing the sulcus, please calculate accordingly. And also remember that there are different A constants when you have done measurements and calculations through the optical or ultrasonic. So don't use the A same constants. Please ask your the aisle manufacturer to provide you the A constants both for the ultrasonic measurements and for the optical measurements. And obviously, as I've already mentioned, optimize. And it says certain special situations. These are the special situations. Please be extra diligent. You'll have to use special formulas. You have to be more careful in your calculations. Thank you.